Simon & Schuster Audio presents Rainbow's End, A Richard Jury Mystery by Martha Grimes. Read by Steve West.
Diane's. Part 1. Sunrise, Salisbury. Chapter 1. He could work out how the men went about it, but how about the women? Made Trevor smile, that did. Great square wells, these guard robes were, and no delicate sign directing you to gents, ladies. Made Trevor laugh as he walked round the fortress, high up on the ramparts, smoking his first cigarette of the day. He tried to ration himself, no more than 10 per. Hard. Helped to have a sense of humour, and he went back to thinking about the privies. It was all for one and one for all. Never mind you had to drop your trousers or lift your skirts. It was a bit of a game with Trevor. At every stop, the postern gate and the bishop's palace, he tried to place himself back in Roman times, pretend he was one of them. Imagined himself as a palace guard one time, maybe working in the bakehouse another time. He could really throw himself into these roles, he could. Trevor considered himself a student of history, and if things had been different when he was young, he could have seen himself at university, reading history, maybe making a name for himself. Oh well, no use crying over spilt milk. Most he could do now was read it on his own. Plenty of time for that, now he'd retired. Selling the tickets here 2 days a week and having his little tour groups several more days a week, at least in summer, for that's when the tourists came to Salisbury. All that could keep a fellow busy. Out of the house and out from under the wife's feet. Out of the house. That was a blessing. He was up above Bishop Roger's palace now, high enough that you really caught that north wind. So he turned up his collar and shoved his mittened hands down in his pockets. February and cold as blazes at this hour. Not that he had to be here at this hour. Of course he didn't. February was a grim old month, wasn't it? Could be depressing if you let yourself sink into it. There was going to be a storm. Trevor could smell the rain long before he heard the thunder. It was that uneven hour just before first light. He loved to see the first flat seam of gold along the horizon make the distant hills behind Salisbury shine like ice hills. Trev thought of the Ice Age. 100,000 years ago, most of the Earth's surface was ice. He tried to imagine a world locked in ice. He tried to think, 100,000 years ago. But his spinning mental globe could not conceive of such distances of time and space. Bloody hell, he could barely get a mental image of the distance between here and Salisbury. Freddie Lake, who shared the ticket kiosk with him, disliked the job, found it boring, too much sameness day in, day out. Nothing to look at but bloody broken walls and tourists. Well, you needed imagination, too, besides your sense of humour, to get on in any job, certainly this one. Just what he'd said to Freddy. It needs imagination, boyo. Lightning struck far off, ornamental. Rain was still pretty far away, but it would come. Hard to judge distances here. Another streak lit up the spire of Salisbury Cathedral. Beautiful, if you had an eye for the arty stuff. And he did. If not history, he should have gone into the arts, have followed some artistic pursuit. Yes, he could appreciate these sunrises, these sunsets. He watched now as the edge of gold, a false light, diminished, diffused into milkiness, and almost disappeared. He was one to appreciate nature, he was. Always had been. He doused his cigarette, wishing he'd waited a bit before lighting up, and blew on his hands, making a bellows of them. Fingers would be frostbitten, handing out the tickets. There wouldn't be many tourists today, not in bloody February. Trevor was coming up on what had struck his funny bone now. One of the guard robes. Just fancy Middle Ages language for cesspits. There were several of them around the site. This was the one just inside the wall that was probably for the guards. Never failed to give him a chuckle. The privies. He walked down the hill a few feet, came to the iron balustrade put up around the big square hole to keep people from falling in. Or maybe pissing in it. What a laugh. He leaned over the iron railing, looked down as far as he could. God, imagine getting out of bed some February morning and having to drag your freezing feet along stone highways and byways until you got to this lot. Trev wondered why it had taken so long to invent plumbing. Not that plumbing was all that great, either. Having to yank on the bloody chain. When it came to the toilet in his house, that meant yanking more than once. He squinted and leaned over the guardrobe a bit farther. Eyes not what they used to be, so he could be wrong. He wasn't wrong. Down there in the thick shadows, at the bottom, something lay. He tried to tell himself it couldn't be a body. Not down there. Only he knew it was. Trevor reared back so abruptly he nearly fell himself, but backward. He started to shout and knew it would be useless. There was nobody within a mile to hear him. He turned in a circle, turned again, as if a ritual were needed to tell him what to do. Come on, boyo, a bit of brain power, a bit of backbone, that's what's needed. Don't fall apart like an old woman. The ticket kiosk, of course. That had a telephone. Get the hospital. No, get the police. Whoever's down there doesn't need an ambulance, not now. He started running, pausing just a second to slip another cigarette into his mouth with shaking hands. Be the death of me, these things will. 2. It was limelight time for Trevor Hastings, and after the initial shocks and shakes, he was hoping he was making the most of it. It wasn't until this Detective Chief Inspector Rush of the Wiltshire CID arrived in his black car and his black raincoat that Trevor began to get nervous. The DCI was pulling his raincoat pockets so tight together you might have thought he was a flasher. Only nothing flashed from Chief Inspector Rush. Not from his body, not from his face. And even then, it wasn't until DCI Rush had put a number of tight-lipped questions to Trevor that Trevor finally twigged it. He himself was looking suspicious. His presence here suspicious. Bloody hell. He had done no more than his civic duty, calling the police. He could have just disappeared, never called anyone. Just got in his mini and driven away. Would have disappeared, wouldn't he, if he'd pushed whoever it was down there, right? Nevertheless, Trevor was asked, no, told, to stay, as if he was a damned dog. Stay. The medical examiner hadn't finished the examination yet. It had taken a bloody long time to winch the body up from that cavernous enclosure. Privy. Trevor had told them. This was a Roman fortress. This was old Sarum. Had they never been here? Lord, the country's fate was in the hands of those who didn't know history. DCI Rush told him to keep yourself available. One of those ways the coppers had of talking just before they slammed you in the nick. Bloody hell. Trev had gone off to the ticket kiosk to warm himself. Let those ones out there stomping all over the icy grass get the frostbite. Ordering honest citizens around. And that poor pile of broken bones ought to make them realize she'd been dead a while. Could have been for days. Not pushed over the iron balustrade early this morning. He stamped his feet to shake some warmth into his toes. Trevor was more incensed than scared. The nerve. Bloody great hulks of blue bottles can't see past their noses. That body could have lain there for days. Well, for one or two, easily, as there'd been not but a handful of visitors.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.